You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Bio 190. My name is Kieran. I am your instructor. Hopefully everybody knows that by now. Today we are joined by Amanda Stovall, who I have been working with the entire time. She, again, another person that surpasses me for time at the aquarium. Today we are going to be talking about polar sea, so the Arctic and Antarctic. And as we always start out our classes, we are going to go live to the aquarium. Once we get back, we'll go over our normal business and introduce Amanda. But since we've got Stacy standing by, we will go live to her. And it looks like today we are going to be visiting the puffins, which is pretty fitting. So, all right, are you there, Stacy? Oh, sorry, we couldn't hear you. One more time.
I'm here. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you loud and clear. So I was just introducing that we are going to be talking about polar seas today and how the puffins fit into that.
Yeah, well, puffins are diving birds. A lot of people think penguins are found pretty much in any place that's cold, but that's not the truth. These are kind of like the penguins of the north in a sense. So these are the birds that you would find up in the Arctic region, and penguins would be found in the Antarctic region. So these guys here, we have three different types of diving birds. We have the pigeon guillemots, and those are the guys who, they kind of look like pigeons, really. The one in the water right there, right in the middle of the screen, that's a pigeon guillemot. Then up on the rocks, those are our puffins. So we have quite a few puffins in there. And we also have crested auklets. And the crested auklet, the little guy over, let's see, kind of to your left, I'm guessing, that is the crested auklet.
Are you able to zoom in on any of the birds? They just look a little bit far away, but it would really be cool to get a good close look up at them.
Sure. Let's see how this works.
There we go.
All right, so the one you're looking at right now, there we go. Now you're looking at it. That is one of our puffins.
Now, you said that these are diving birds. Our exhibit has some depth to it, so do we actually get to see them dive in the water there?
Yeah, they were just a moment ago, so we just missed it. Oh, we had one just pop up right now.
They are known
for diving.
Oh, sorry, go ahead, Stacey, what were you saying?
Oh, they're definitely known for diving. That's how they get their food. The smaller beaked ones tend to eat smaller things like krill, and the larger beaked ones like this one here will tend to eat larger fish or small fish, but larger-ish prey. So something like an anchovy or a capon.
Now, they don't live actually in the ocean, right? They are ones that do some nesting around rocky areas. So although we are talking about the polar seas today, we wouldn't find these like out to sea all day where they're never on land, right?
They do breed on land. That's where their nests are, in the rocky cliffs. But in the wintertime when they're not breeding, you're going to find them out in the ocean, which is where they're going to find their food. So the other little guy that just popped in there, the lighter colored one, that's the pigeon guillemot.
Perfect. All right, so that is a good look, and I love that you pointed out that these are not penguins. I think it always cracks me up when we used to get people that would come to the aquarium and say, oh, your penguins up by the sea jellies, and we say, oh, no, we have puffins. Oh, no, they're penguins. Well, they're puffins. They're a little bit different. We will talk a little bit more about that on our bird day, but we just wanted to introduce you to a bird that is well known for living way up in the cold. Now, Stacy, real quick before we go, how do these animals stay warm? Do you know, in these really cold environments?
They have amazingly awesome feathers. They have a lot of feathers for a bird, and the feathers kind of interlock together. And the best part about that is they actually have an air layer that is trapped between their feathers and their skin. So the cold water of the north doesn't actually get to their skin, and that's how they stay warm.
And that's pretty common in birds that live in either water conditions or very cold conditions, right?
Correct.
Awesome. All right, Stacy, well, thank you for taking us to our puffins and diving birds exhibit. So we will touch a little bit more about these guys on Bird Day, and we'll actually probably take a look at penguins on that day as well. So thank you very, very much.
All right, catch you later.
All right, bye, Stacy. All right, so now to get started, I'm just going to go over a couple of things before we get into today's topic and learn a little bit more from Amanda. We have a lot of stuff coming up. So the midterm is going to be opening on October 22nd. So we are already almost halfway through the class, which is crazy. The midterm is going to be on the first half of the class, so it'll be cumulative from the first six classes. And then that week, you will also have that quiz. So you're going to have your normal weekly quiz, your normal weekly discussion board. And then you'll have one more assignment, the midterm, that week as well. It'll be open for a week, just like a quiz. It's going to be a little bit more questions, about 30 questions. So it's a little bit more intense than our quizzes. But again, it's on everything we've already talked about. So don't forget, everyone's looking good on quizzes and discussion boards. If you have questions, of course, email me. You can email me at bio190@lbaop.org. And then today we are going to be doing something a little bit different. I'll be introducing this after the break. But instead of doing an extra credit today live where you're going to either respond or call in, I'm going to be introducing an extra credit lab assignment. So I think it'll be pretty fun. Amanda and I were chatting about it, and it definitely pertains to today's information. And then... oh, Caleb wanted to respond real quick. He said, so I guess diving birds are the kind that plunge or lunch. Haha. I feel like Carlos from the Magic School Bus. Yes, plunge for lunch. Definitely plunge for lunch. Yeah, and you'll see them kind of bob too. It's pretty awesome. So, all right, thank you for that, Caleb. And then the other thing coming up, don't forget research proposal. Again, I cannot emphasize that this is going to be a challenging paper, but I think a very rewarding paper. Do not procrastinate on this one. The research proposal that I said I would put up as an example is up in the assignment. So if you go to that assignment, you'll notice there is now another document in there that you can download that will show you what it is I'm looking for. There's an example paper up there. Our field trip paper is due in about a month, so hopefully everyone has either gone on their field trip or has it planned in the near future, so you can get that observational based paper into me. Other than that, I think that's everything I needed to talk to you about. Don't forget, you can participate as Caleb just did already off the bat. So feel free to email or call in to partake in our discussion today. If you have any questions, comments, anything that you want to bring up, we can address that in class for you today as well. So 1-800-339-1193 to call in. And with that, let's introduce you to Amanda. So hello, Amanda. Thank you for being here today.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
So Amanda, like I said, has been working with me at the aquarium for a long time. So Amanda, why don't you catch us up a little bit about yourself, introduce yourself to the students and where you come from and what you do.
Okay. Well, I started at the aquarium. Boy, this is my, I've worked here 11 years already. And I actually came from Michigan. I did not grow up around the ocean at all, but at the young age of 8, I decided I loved whales and dolphins after my first trip to SeaWorld, and back when they had one in Ohio. And I decided I wanted to do a job having to do with whales and dolphins. So I got my degree in zoology because Michigan didn't have a whole lot of marine biology programs. So I went to Michigan State University, and then eventually I came out here. I worked as a volunteer at a marine mammal care center working with seals and sea lions, and was a part of their rescue and rehabilitation so we could release them back into the wild, which was a lot of fun. And then I also worked at another nearby aquarium as a whale watch coordinator, and now I work in the education department. Worked here for 12 years now, and have had a blast. I get the privilege of going out sometimes with Kira on the boats and getting to see the blue whales and the whales that are migrating right off our coast and all the dolphins that call Long Beach home, and get to work with the photo ID interns that are actually taking pictures of them and identifying them. So it's a lot of fun, and besides that, it's just a fun place to work. But that's kind of my background.
Yes, so that is true. Amanda and I work very closely together with the photo ID set that she's talking about on Mammal Day. We'll get to talk more about that. And who knows, maybe some of our Bio190 students will end up as our interns one day.
That's right.
That would be kind of awesome. You'll learn all about that later. So, all right, let's jump in, literally. Not literally.
No,
to the polar oceans. So let's jump in figuratively to the polar oceans discussion today. So we are going to start by talking about the northern hemisphere first. So we'll be talking about the Arctic, the North Pole, where Santa Claus lives. That's the way we describe it. When we're talking to little kids, we always say, oh, what's another name for the Arctic? The North Pole, where Santa lives. So we'll be talking about the North Pole first, and then the second half of class will be more aimed at the South Pole. So the Arctic Ocean, let's talk about what the Arctic Ocean even is.
Okay, well, the Arctic in general is pretty much an ocean. There is land that surrounds it. And so if you think about the Arctic versus the Antarctic, usually we think, well, they're pretty similar. They're cold, right? Cold and icy, and you probably see penguins on both sides. But of course, we talked about how you don't see the penguins in the North Pole. But really what the Arctic is water, an ocean that is surrounded by land. So if you look at the picture that's behind us.
And we can pull that full screen too, and that'll help a little bit here.
You'll actually see that there are a number of countries that are all a part of the Arctic, some of that land around where the ocean is. But the Arctic itself, where we think of the North Pole, is actually in water. However, that water happens to be frozen because of the conditions up there. But it is an area of water, a body of water, an ocean that's surrounded by land in several countries, so not just one.
I think that's a perfect way to explain it. Frozen ocean, because as we talk about the Antarctic later, we'll learn that that's not quite frozen ocean. It's a little bit different. So yeah, the ocean surrounded by land, and it has an average depth of about 3,658 meters. So I didn't realize it was that deep. I don't know, I just don't picture it as being deep, but
well, we think about it being something you could walk on because it's frozen most of the time. But yes, below that, there is actually still a lot of water.
And we'll be talking a lot about what's going on under the water tonight and the animals that rely on that as well. Now, this is pretty small, right?
Yes, this is the smallest of the five oceans, depending on how many oceans people count there to be. But generally, it's accepted that there are five oceans. So the Arctic, you have the Southern Ocean, we'll talk about later, the Pacific, Atlantic, and the Indian Ocean, of course.
Yes.
But this is the smallest of the five.
Smallest of the five. So that just about sums it up. And that doesn't mean it's small, though. It is still 1.5 times the size of the United States. So we're not talking about any small little ice cap here.
No, it's definitely quite
all right, so it says the Arctic ice may also be 6 to 15 feet thick, depending on the location of the ice and the time of the year, which we will kind of get into that time of the year here pretty short. But in general, when we think about the Arctic, I think it's kind of confusing about how their summers and winters differ, because their summers don't really have nighttime, right?
Well, it's funny. There's a lot of fluidity, really, in the Arctic. As far as the shape of the Arctic, the size of the Arctic, overall, the ocean is, yes, 1.5 times the size of the United States, but the amount of frozen ice is always changing with mm-hmm. the seasons. Now, their seasons are a little bit different than our seasons. When we think about the summer, we think, oh, nice weather, it's nice and warm, and while it is warmer there in the summer mm-hmm. because they do have more sunlight, they're closer to the sun, they have really, really long days. Most people know that they mm-hmm. have the midnight sun. So 24 hours they have sunlight. And so it warms things up a little bit. And during that time, definitely the ice starts to shrink. And so the size of it gets a lot smaller. However, even though you might think the summer must be the nicest time to go to the Arctic if you want to go on a trip, no, that's not the case. They actually have really harsh conditions. That's the time when there's cyclones. Mm. The weather conditions are not very stable, not very suitable for doing research. So it's actually really difficult to learn about the Arctic in the summer, because the conditions are usually so harsh, even though you can see really well and it might be a little bit warmer.
Which however, is interesting, right?
Yeah. Interesting. However, in the winter, when they don't have any sunlight, it's 24 hours of darkness, the conditions are a little bit more stable and not as not as much of the craziness. You just can't see very well.
And that's really, yeah, that's really interesting. So we actually have a video that I want to show you that's going to kind of show how, we have a couple actually, the ice transitions, like you said initially, in the summertime, the amount of sea ice there is versus the wintertime is much different. They call this perennial ice. So there's ice that's there all year long, summer or winter, but then in the winter months, there's more ice because obviously it's colder, it freezes, in the summertime it recedes. In the summertime or the wintertime, it comes out again and then it recedes. So we'll show you kind of what that looks like. This is based off of models of real data. So if we can show that first video here, you'll be able to see it. There we go. All right, so this is up at the Arctic. So you'll notice we can just kind of guess what type of year it is based off of how much ice there is. So we're going into a summertime when it's warmer. You'll still see that top ice does not completely go away. And then we're into wintertime. And summertime, and wintertime. So we'll just watch this go around, all the way around the Earth just one time here. But this is a great visual to show it's like frozen ocean. You can really see how it's ocean here, especially when it recedes, that we just see all that blue like it's just frozen water.
I also think it's fascinating to watch all the land that gets covered with snow, too.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I always notice the Great Lakes.
Yeah. So all the way down to the United States, you can just really see it.
So again, even though it's always cold there, there are some pretty dramatic changes between mm-hmm. the seasons. And so, I don't know, it's kind of an interesting and ever-changing sort of area.
I have another video that's just showing summer months. So if we can pull that second video up, we'll be able to see, and this will show you a time lapse with the months. I think it's May through August. But this will show you what it looks like in the receding part. So when we talk later in the class today about sea ice, melting, it's not the annual melting so much as it is the lowest point of the ice from one year compared to the next year compared to the next year. And this will show you how much recedes in such a short period of time. So if we can pull that second video up. So this is May. So this is like the beginning of summer. Things are just kind of starting to heat up a little bit. June. July. And then we only get to August 15th here, but it will continue to recede usually up until September. September typically is the month that's at the end of the summer, so it's been the warmest, and that's when they'll have the shortest amount of ice up there. And then they'll compare usually September to September to September to see on average, do we have less ice than the year before at the same time? So we'll get into that a little bit more. But when we see that, what is the average amount of miles that we'll see in the winter like versus the summer?
It's about a doubling. If you were to take, or I guess you should say half, if you looked at the whole Arctic in the summer months, it is going to be the size approximately, or I'm sorry, in the winter, it's going to be about 5.8 million, million square miles.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you were to compare that later, once it's had a chance to warm up and get smaller, it's only going to be 2.7 miles. A million, not 2.7 miles, it's a lot bigger than that. 2.7 million square miles.
That's significant.
Yeah, it's nearly half.
So then that's kind of what we were showing there in that video. You can just see it literally retreating all the way back up. Now with this, we kind of want to talk about how this ice is formed. So I'm going to go to a website here that we have on the computer. And this is, I know there's a lot going on here. Amanda and I were actually having a conversation about this before the class today. That there's a lot to this, but we will kind of walk you through the steps here as to how we get that ice made, because I know when I was first learning about the polar seas, I thought why do the seas freeze? I didn't think that the seas could freeze, but they can if they reach certain temperatures. And this little visual we'll show you here will kind of walk you through a little bit of how all of the sea ice comes to be. So if we can go to the computer here, and I will post this website if you want to see a little bit more of it. Basically, we can kind of see we've got Canada right here. This is obviously the United States down here, Alaska, and then we've got the North Atlantic current coming in here, and then we've got the Bering Strait right here. So we're going to start right here, right, Amanda, at the Bering Strait?
Yes. So the water is coming in from the Pacific Ocean, coming up through the Bering Strait in Alaska. And that water is, it's cold water. It's definitely cold water, but it's going to get even colder because as it comes through, what's going to happen is those really, really cold winds that are coming from the interior of Alaska are going to start freezing that water. Now, when the salt water freezes, it lets go of its salt because salt water doesn't really freeze. So you have a fresh, frozen fresh water with all these little channels going through it where the salt is coming out of it, and that salt is spilling out into the water around it. So you've got this freezing water that's being cooled at the surface from the incoming wind coming off of Alaska. And then it pushes that wind continues to cool that water, freeze that water, and then push it away and pushes it out to sea.
So that would push it here up into the North Pole, is that right?
Exactly.
That's what, yeah.
And so now that ice has moved out of the way, we've got saltier seas, and we also have new water that's coming in through the Bering Strait that is ready to get frozen. So this basically works as this little conveyor belt and ice factory where the ice is constantly being made and then pushed out, and then as more water comes in, it gets frozen, it, you know, pushes out its salt, and it then gets moved on down by the wind, and then gets caught up in this Beaufort gyre that we have there.
So this thing that's kind of moving everything around here, so it's like grabs the ice, pushes it, moves it, gets it in the gyre, gets it going, and then continues on.
Yes.
So we'll just kind of show you this. We'll let you sit with this for a second. If you're interested in learning more about this, I mean, is there anything else we wanted to add on to that?
Well, there's also something that happens, the halocline or halocline, where we have this, as this salt is being emptied out into the water, well, that salt is very dense. It causes that water to become very, very dense. And so it settles down to the bottom. But another thing we have to remember is that there's this warm water that's coming
right
up into
here.
The area from the North Atlantic current. And it's actually going to go underneath this colder water, or it's already there. It's very salty water too, but it's going underneath the cold water. And this sort of buffer that we have prevents that really, really warm water from causing all the ice on top to melt. So it actually forms this little layer, this thermal, I don't know, sort of...
thermal haline almost, right?
Yeah. So even though the water is becoming saltier when it first comes in at steps 1, 2, and 3, it's still not as salty as the very salty water that's coming in the warmer water. So that warmer water is going to go beneath that dense cold water so that it's not just immediately melting all of that ice that's up there in the Arctic.
And this goes through, if you're interested in this and this kind of gets you excited, then you can come onto this website. It'll go through the steps. These conditions can change. It's not like it's a one-way ticket. Talks about like in step 4, like how the winds will shift and then how the water works its way back through the strait. So you can take a look here and just kind of mess around with this. You can click on the numbers here that'll kind of walk you through the typical steps and kind of show you a little bit more about how ice is moved and pushed. But the big thing right here is, as Amanda was saying in the beginning, is that water comes through. And the Alaskan winds really help to make that ice factory go. Mm-hmm. All right, Wes, we have a question. Which gets colder, the South Arctic or the North Arctic? If you're referring to the North, are you talking about North South Pole, like Antarctic, or I'm not sure I understand.
Because the Arctic, it's kind of hard. If you go too far north in the Arctic, it's just going to be frozen. So if you're talking about the latitude, maybe like the closer you're getting to the pole, is it closer to the pole versus, I don't know, we're trying to understand.
And, yeah, question. Unless you're talking about North Pole versus South Pole, so Antarctica versus the Arctic. I don't know what the extreme temperatures are of both.
Well, if you're comparing the two poles, it's definitely colder in the Antarctic.
Do you
they
know
have
how
the
much?
Record. I want to say it's negative. It was negative 80. I'll double check.
Yeah.
Negative 83 degrees Fahrenheit, I think in 1980 something. I think I have notes on that in here somewhere. We'll get back to that.
we'll get to that.
But yeah, they held the record for being the coldest. So
wow.
It does get colder in the Antarctic.
I would not. Well, we have Emily who went there, and she talks about how she had to gain weight before she went just because she was going to lose so much from losing all the body heat. But we'll talk about that. Emily will actually join us later in the semester as well. All right, so that's kind of how the Arctic is formed. We get that seasonal ice there, and then there's a whole community, a whole ecosystem, well, numerous ecosystems, really, that move around this area. So we're going to just dive into some of these ecosystems a little bit, talk about some food webs, because the Arctic is a little bit different than the Antarctic, so we'll get to see a little bit of how that goes. Now, when we were talking about sea ice forming, that actually kind of starts to pave the way for this food web.
It does, because as that ice is forming, what's happening, like I said, is as the salt is leaving the ice, it's creating little channels. And in these channels, you have some of this salty water called brine that actually other animals and algae can live in. And that kind of is what starts the basis of the food chain in the Arctic. So if you look at the, I think right here, you can actually see some of the brine channels. So these things that are hanging down that look kind of like little stalactites or something are actually areas where the water is flowing out, and then any of the water that's around it, that the water that's surrounding where it's coming out, is going to get frozen. It's really, really cold, but because that salt coming out is so such a high concentration of salt, it's not freezing as it's coming through, but it does freeze the water that's around it and makes these little
tunnels,
little
or
channels tubes or tubes, yeah.
And then within there, really, that's where the food web can begin, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, algae can live in there, and then animals will feed on that algae. That's kind of a complex little thing going on in there.
It is, and as this algae continues to grow, some of the algae can get up to 2 feet long, even, that hang down from below the sea ice. So even though it can't get up to the surface, and it's not, you don't have plants that are necessarily growing there, well, in some areas of the Arctic you do, but if you're talking about just the ice, you can get life that's growing on the underside that is giving life to all the animals that are living underneath the ice. And so you've got plankton that can feed on the algae that's growing there. You've got other animals that are feeding on the plankton. And then, of course, we can go quite a ways up the food chain. We've got some pretty big predators in the Arctic.
And when that algae, like those long pieces of algae, die, that'll actually feed the whole community on the bottom as well, right?
Yes, because there's a whole section of animals that don't really spend much time in the water column. They actually spend their time in vertebrates that are down on the bottom. So they're benthic creatures living down there. And so when that algae does fall down, it provides food for them to enjoy while they're down there.
Right, and here's a look, if we can go full screen on this, you can see this is some of those brine channels that we were talking about with the algae and all the other little organisms that will live in there. So there's worms, crustaceans, algae, bacteria, just really, literally, all up in this section here. And then in addition to that, when we were saying, as Amanda was saying, when it dies, that algae will fall to the bottom and it feeds a whole other community of organisms. So really kind of an interesting dynamic in food web just based off of salt creating these tunnels in the ice.
Yeah, it really is interesting because it's not just in the ice itself. And I always thought these channels were just in the ice, but then when I saw some of the beautiful videos that you can find on the internet, of these channels that are coming down, like I said, they look kind of like stalactites. So neat.
Super cool. Channels. So that's kind of like the little parts of the food web there, where we're talking about the little animals. But let's start to work up the food web a little bit more to some of the bigger animals. Real quick, and sorry, I do not know how to say your name. Do you want to guess it? I'm not sure.
Fatima,
maybe? So it says this, I'm really sorry if I messed that up. The South Pole's record low temperature was -117.04 degrees Fahrenheit, or I'm assuming -82.8 degrees Celsius. So that's, yeah, you were almost right on it.
Yeah.
pretty close. All right, so let's talk about some of the fish of the Arctic. So there are about 240 species of fish that live in the Arctic. Oh, this is a great shop. Actually, before we move on, can we get this full screen as well?
Oh, yeah.
This is a food web of the Arctic. So we can see we've got ice algae down here. So it's ice algae, phytoplankton, and then we have different debris here, kind of like detritus or dead floating stuff or leftover stuff. And then we've got the plant eaters. So we've got the little microorganisms all the way up to primary and secondary predators, where up here we've got gulls, Arctic foxes, polar bears, which we were talking about 10 minutes ago, some whales, and then seals. So walruses are another big one. So these are all kind of the big guys here. But we also have crabs. Crabs are really abundant up there as well. So just a huge food web. I mean, this is, again, only a sample of it, but we'll be talking kind of right now about the middle guys, those fish. So over 240 species of fish, but there aren't many pelagic fish, right? Not many open ocean fish.
No, they're not. Most of them are benthic, so they'll feed on the bottom. Some of them are demersal, but for the most part, they're staying on the bottom, which is where all the invertebrates are for them to feed on. And so if they're feeding on all these animals on the bottom, they need to have some special things to help them out with that. And one of the interesting animals that I think that live out there are these animals called eel pouts, very interesting fish. And what's funny about them is they actually have this cartilaginous lower jaw that they'll use to scoop things up out of the sand. They'll actually make little caves for burrowing in the bottom of the seafloor as well. We have another low temperature.
So James is telling us the lowest temperature recorded for the North Pole was negative, I'm guessing negative 68 degrees Celsius, so negative 90.4 degrees Fahrenheit. So a little bit of a difference there.
I mean,
that's 20, almost 15 degrees Celsius. That's significant. So thank you for that, by the way. Sorry, I did not mean to interrupt you, but back to our eel pouts.
Okay, so our eel pouts, they have these big funny jaws. Do we actually have a picture of
Yes, we have a picture of an eel pout. If we can show the picture of the eel pout. Yeah, they do the cartilaginous jaw. I would love to get a video of them feeding. That would be pretty cool.
That would be neat.
All right, so here's the eel pout.
So kind of a long, slender, skinny fish, but he does have a strange cartilaginous jaw. They'll eat crustaceans, worms, clams, brittle stars, and other fish. So just kind of weird. Not the most attractive looking animal, but kind of interesting.
And their body is designed to help kind of wiggle in and dig these like little caves or little caveats to get in and find food or burrow down. So typically when you see an animal that's kind of this long shape, we tend to see them burrowing a little bit, right?
Okay. Yep.
So that's a good example of one of the animals, that cartilaginous jaw. And then we also have a snailfish, which is a relative to lump suckers, which I love lump suckers. I think they are adorable. But a snailfish, if we can pull that little guy up, I think he's pretty cute too.
I think he's kind of cute. Maybe not as cute as the lump suckers we have at the aquarium.
I'm doing the girly thing. It's so cute.
I don't know. I still think our lump suckers are cuter. But the snailfish is interesting because just like snails, you think about snails that move along, they stick to the edges of aquariums. You can see them on the underside sticking. They can also, these guys have a sucking disc as well on the underside of their body. So they'll use that to attach to rocks, algae, other objects. And they don't have any scales on their body either. So a little bit more snail-like in that area. So maybe a little bit more, I don't know what they feel like, but I imagine they probably have some sort of slime sort of covering over them, as many of the fish do that don't have scales.
So this would be some of the lower, like fish that we said, or middle guys in the food web there. Liking scales is kind of interesting. Like, there's got to be some adaptations, like, that allow it to live in such cold water, and I don't know.
I don't know why they don't have scales.
It would be interesting to find out. So, all right, so that's a couple examples of the fish. And then the last thing we're going to talk about are the mammals of the Arctic. And mammals of the Arctic, there are quite a few. One of the ones that we like to bring up, I think, the most is the gray whale, because the gray whale utilizes the Arctic, but we see them all the way down here in Southern California, and they've got quite the migration.
They do. They have one of the longest migrations known of any mammal. And they are, you know, special to us because we see them here off our coast and we get to go on whale watching trips and watch them every winter. But they start up near Alaska, which is where they spend, in the Bering and Chukchi Seas, which is where they spend their times just eating. Just eat all summer long. They just eat. They feed on krill. And then once it starts getting colder, they come on down along the coast, right down by California. And then they head on down to Mexico, which is where they have their breeding grounds, where they mate and they have their calves. And then eventually they'll head on back up north and start feeding for the summer again.
So if we can pull this full screen, let's take a look really at how far their migration really is. So we're talking about areas up in here, right? So we're talking about up into the cold Arctic. And I think you said krill, but I think you meant amphipods, right?
Oh, sorry, so I did say
for
krill.
The,
I meant
the feeding up here. So they're going to start up here. And as we have already mentioned, that a lot of the food starts at the bottom. We have all those invertebrates at the bottom, and they are a whale that filter feeds on animals in the mud. And we have a video that we'll show you on Mammal Day that's pretty impressive of how they do this. But just kind of going with the theme that a lot of the food web there starts with the inverts on the bottom. And then in the winter time, because it gets super cold, here they come all the way down here. You can follow this little red thing. We're here. And they're going to go all the way past us down here to the lagoons of Mexico. What is that roughly in mileage, Amanda?
It depends on where they start, but it can be around 12,000 miles, 10,000 round trip.
Yeah, which is pretty significant. I mean, if we have a whale that goes from here all the way here, obviously that's like 14. Longest case,
yeah.
Right? So, but there are some that maybe start here, here. There are even some that kind of hang out here. And there's actually a population that hangs out off of Oregon pretty much all year long. So we're talking about quite a migration here, especially for the guys that start up here. But we get to see them twice. And as we mentioned, you know, it's really cold up there. Having a baby in super cold environments in the Arctic would not work, right?
No, it would. The poor babies would freeze. So these whales are smart. They know where to go, just like we go to the warmer spots to vacation and not usually have our babies, but they go to the warmer spots, they have their party down there, and then they have their calves where it's nice and warm water. And usually the mothers with the calves stay down there a little bit longer, so it gives them more time to build up that blubber layer, which is really important for their energy and for their insulation. And so they have time to get kind of that layer of fat before they head on back up to the really, really cold waters.
Yeah, definitely. So again, I don't know, I'm just always astounded by how much they travel for that, how they know to do that. Like, there's lots of research, like how do they even know to do that? How do they know when to leave the Arctic? What are the cues that they get? So really impressive. We had Allie, how big are these fish? So going back to the eel pouts and the snail fish, the ones that we've shown today are not big, big fish. There are much bigger fish that live up there. I think the snail fish is a little bit bigger than some of the lump suckers that we've had, so
yeah,
my guess is
about that range.
Yeah, not very big. We showed, like I said, some small ones, but there are some that get to be pretty large. All right, and then going back to the mammals here, so that's obviously whales aren't the only ones that live up there, right?
No. We've got pinnipeds, and have you guys talked about pinnipeds
no,
yet?
No, Mammal Days is in a couple weeks.
Oh, okay, so in case you don't know what a pinniped is yet, that refers to seals, sea lions, and walruses. And the Arctic is one of the areas that actually does have walruses. So seals, sea lions, and walruses, as well as cetaceans, not just whales, but, I guess just the whales. I don't know of too many dolphin species that are up there in the Arctic. So
you could probably find some.
Yeah, there's probably some that wander up there. But
yeah. And then polar bears, right?
Is a really big one.
So we were talking about this. I'm like, how did I not bring a picture of a polar bear for today's lecture? So we found one on a website. So if we can go back to the computer real quick, we pulled up National Geographic's website on polar bears. And polar bears, again, are just an animal that I love them. I don't know why. They look all cute and cuddly, but they're actually really, really vicious and ferocious. But polar bears are an animal that live up in the Arctic, and I think it's important that we talk about polar bears living in the Arctic, because the one place that they do not live
is the Antarctic.
So polar bears are going to be strictly a Arctic animal. And there's lots of information about them. If we were to scroll, oops, sorry, I'm just going to go back to this. If we scroll back down on the computer here, this particular site will talk to you about where they live. As we talk about global climate change and how the polar regions are shifting a little bit, there has been some concern for the polar bear because of that seasonal ice decreasing each year. So this is one animal that there's a lot of eyes on right now because they're concerned what's going to happen if that ice isn't there, or there's so little ice, how are they going to find their food and forage? So big debate topics there. Wes, killer whales live up there. Yes, they do. Killer whales are one of my favorites.
So technically, they are part of the dolphin family.
Yes,
you're right,
that's
Wes.
True. That's true. Thank you for that one. All right, so Polar bears, yes, perfect. All right, so moving on, we're gonna show you one more little video. This is going to wrap up our Arctic section that talks about some things that are going on there, as I mentioned, with the ice melting, right? So each year the ice seems to be, roughly on average, less than previous years, right?
Well, they're seeing a trend. I think actually last year we had a better season than the year before. But things are always changing, and we're still kind of trying to get a grasp on what it all means. Nobody knows for sure, but just trying to document it and see what's happening. But yeah, we are seeing, as you talked about earlier, how we take the readings in September. And when you want to start comparing years and how the ice is changing, you always need to do it from the same point. You can't say, oh, well, look at the summer of this year. It was so much less than the winter of another year. Obviously, you need to compare at the same time. And in September, even though a lot of the country, it starts cooling down, and you think, oh, well, it's so much warmer later, you have to remember that water takes a lot longer to heat up, and it absorbs that energy and that heat and holds it actually a lot longer than land does. Land will constantly be changing their temperature throughout the day, whereas the ocean takes a lot longer to cool and warm. But yes, we are seeing definite changes and a reduction or more loss of ice in the Arctic than in previous years.
And we have a video, so if we can pull that video up, we can show you what it looks like. So again, this is based off of data models that will show this seasonal ice. So this is going to take a minute or so, but we're starting from 1980 all the way up to current, or 2012, I think. And you can see there's fluctuations. It'll go up, it'll go down. It'll go up, it'll go down. Like this year is higher than the previous year. And but one of the things to notice is that even though we're going up, our overall trend, as Amanda said, tends to be going down. So this is, we'll show this kind of graph here with it in the background, and then we have it showing again after this with just the background.
And they're saying that the average temperatures in the Arctic have raised almost twice. They've increased the rate of twice the rate of temperatures in other parts of the world. So there definitely is concern and focus on this area in the Arctic specifically. Why is it getting so much warmer here, so much faster than in other areas? So they definitely have noticed the rate. Now, there's actually a couple reasons why they assume this is happening, because you'll notice, what is that beautiful color that you see right in the very center? It's white, right? And we all know that white tends to reflect heat. So it's reflecting the heat of the sun. But then we also have, as that ice is getting smaller, as it's warming up, not only is the water warming up, the ice is warming and melting, but now we're also losing that layer of reflection that the Earth has to reflect back the rays of the sun. So that's why they're thinking this seems like it's having such a bigger effect. Why are the temperatures rising twice the rate as other mm-hmm. parts? Well, maybe it's because the ice itself, as it's melting, we're also losing this extra reflective layer that's been keeping the Earth cool, so keeping
right.
that area cool.
And as it reflects, right, so if less heat reflects from the white, then that means more is being absorbed in the water, more water, or the water is getting warmer, then making more ice melt, that then is less reflective, that then makes more blue for absorption. So it's right. this thing we call a positive feedback, in the sense that it just keeps on going, keeps on going, keeps on going. Exactly. So that is a little bit about the Arctic. So we are going to wrap there for now and go on our break. So we will take about a 5-minute break, and then when we get back, I will introduce our kind of new extra credit opportunity coming up. So we will see you in about 5 minutes. Get a drink, get some snack, whatever, and we'll see you back here in a couple.
You're watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Yeah. I basically took the distance learning course because I'm trying to get my California credential. I'm an out-of-state teacher. It's very convenient. I took last semester the health course from Joanna Chase, and I found that to be to my liking. I could study, relax, do it casually in the confines of my home.
I took one of the distance learning classes basically for convenience. It was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or you know, if it didn't work out that way, I could tape it and kind of watch it at my own leisure.
Well, I took the distance learning course because it's I'm able to watch the videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch it at home or either at the media center. And I would recommend this to a friend.
My name is Ileana Gutierrez. I'm a communications major here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I have my own radio show at KDHR, our on-campus radio station. The reason I chose Cal State Dominguez Hills is because of its beautiful campus and cultural diversity.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as a entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, welcome back. So real quick, what I want to do is introduce to you an extra credit lab that I'm going to be posting probably tomorrow, maybe Thursday at the latest. I have to try a couple things out. I might want to switch something up on it. But basically, the whole idea of this lab is to compare the Arctic conditions to the Antarctic conditions. And that's basically all I'm going to tell you about that. But what you're going to be doing is getting a bowl of water. And there's certain amounts of water you're going to use, and then you're going to need some ice as well. You can either use ice cubes, or you can just get a measuring cup and fill it up with water and freeze that. But keep in mind, then you're going to have to use a little bit of water to work the big cube out of the cup. So all of that will be in the lab write-up. But what you're going to do is be testing for the height of your water depending on what you do with your ice cube. So you'll need to actually make two, one for each experiment, one for the Arctic version, one for the Antarctic version. So either freeze two cups of ice or do one day and then the other one another day. And then when you put your water in your bowl, the first thing you're going to do is add your big ice cube and measure the water. Put or measure the height of that water just either with a little pencil or a marker or something inside of your bowl, so you can, or on the outside of your bowl, so you can see where the level is. Wait for that ice cube to melt. You're going to be taking measurements for about 30 minutes. And then at the end, when your ice cube has melted, you will see what the water has done. If it's risen, gone down, the same, and you'll make measurements and answer some questions about that. The second part of the experiment is very similar, except this time in your bowl, so you need to have a pretty big bowl, you're going to need to put a platform in there, kind of like an island. You want to put an island in your bowl that is from the bottom of the bowl all the way to at least the water line. So you'll put your island in your bowl. I think in the write-up I said a block of wood. You'll put in your water, and then you're going to take your ice that you have then created. This is your second big ice cube. Put it on top of your island and watch it melt and take some measurements and then answer some questions about that. So it might sound a little confusing. When you see the write-up, it'll make perfect sense, but we're going to be comparing Arctic and Antarctic conditions. So that will be your extra credit write-up. I'll give you 2 weeks to do it from the day I open it. So again, I'll have it open the next day or two, so kind of look for that. And this is an opportunity for 5 extra credit points. So really good. One of the things that you have to do to get your full 5 extra credit points is take a picture of you doing it. I want to see the picture of both of your experiments, for the one with the little island and one without the island. And then also I'm going to want to see your data sheet, either typed up or written up, and then of course answering the question. So it's a pretty easy opportunity to get some extra credit points. Hopefully it will drive home some of the points we're making today and also prepare you for a future lecture on global climate change, sea level rise, and some other good stuff towards the end of the semester. So 5 extra credit points. I will post that up, and I will also probably post a video with you. I'm telling you a little bit more about it as well. All right, so welcome back again. We're now going to be moving on to the Antarctic or Southern Ocean and discussing some of the differences between the Arctic and the Antarctic. But first, let's just talk about in general, what is Antarctica?
Well, Antarctica, if you were to look at, well, I think most of us know from school, it is a continent, right? It's land. And so the Antarctic refers to the region, the South Pole region, but it also refers to that area of land and the water that surrounds it. So it's actually quite the opposite of the Arctic, because you have the Antarctic landmass, Antarctica, and then you've got the water that surrounds it, whereas in the Arctic you had the land that was surrounding the Arctic.
And that is a pretty good size too. We talked about how the Arctic was roughly 1.5 times the size of the United States. This is twice the size of the United States. So this is a perfect example. We have the land mass essentially here, and then all of this out here kind of sort of plays a role in Antarctica too, because that will freeze and kind of sort of be attached to the land mass there. So that makes it a little bit different. It also gets up to 15,000 feet deep. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Now, this one is a little bit harder to define, though, the boundaries of it. In the Arctic, we had a very clear boundary of where the ocean was versus where the land is. The land was providing that boundary. These, you know, the Southern and Indian Ocean kind of blend together, the Southern and Pacific Ocean kind of blend together. So it's not as clearly defined, whereas even somebody was telling me yesterday, they're like, well, I grew up thinking there were only 4 oceans, and there was no Southern Ocean back then. So things are always changing.
Yes, definitely. I agree. No, I agree. The Southern Ocean, I think that was, yeah, when we're talking about that, some people just say, oh, well, it's one world ocean. But in this case, it's a little bit more defined in the sense that when we talk about the Southern Ocean, like you said, kind of attached or not exactly easy to say the boundaries, but part of or surrounding that landmass. So Antarctica is a large landmass that is buried under a vast ice cap. So that's where the whole confusion of ice comes into play, right? We think of the Arctic ice, we think of Antarctic ice, but it's different.
It is different because here we have the ice that's on the land, and there is also ice that spreads out into the ocean as well. And these ice shelves will break off, and you'll hear people refer to calving, which is when the big glaciers and the big ice is breaking off into the ocean. But we have all of this area of Antarctica that's also covered in one massive ice sheet. We've never seen, I mean, there is no other place on Earth that's like that. And it can be very thick, and in fact, let's see.
It says 4 kilometers thick.
Which is about 2.5 miles, so about 2.5 miles thick. That's that's some major ice. And the land in Antarctica, it's not just like a flat desert. There's actually some big mountains there. Mount Vinson, is that, did I say
yeah,
that right?
Yeah, Vinson, yeah.
Is 16,066 feet, which is a little bit larger, or a little, yeah, just a little bit larger than Mount Whitney. California. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, I think it's pretty incredible, too, that the weather is different. You were talking about, like, cyclones and stuff in the Arctic, but Antarctica is actually very dry. It's not like there's snowstorms and snow. We're talking about ice. So when you said ice sheet, that's exactly what it is. It's not snow sheet. It's ice sheet.
It's ice sheet, yes. And it is. It's actually considered the driest continent that we have. A lot of times we think of Africa, big desert, big area that's really, really dry. Well, Antarctica is even drier than Africa is. So it's considered the driest continent.
There are lots of people that will go there and study, though. So we talked about our coworker, Emily, who will be here later in the semester. She has been down there twice, and there's actual like stations and everything set up there, right?
Yeah, there's a lot of countries, a lot of scientists are there that work together and use these stations that we have so we can learn more about this very bizarre place on our planet. However, it's different again than the Arctic, because here you have the Arctic has a lot of different countries that are there that are part of that Arctic region, whereas this is nobody really owns it.
It's no man's land.
A lot of people, the only people that live there are not, you know, in the Arctic you have people who live there, who grew up Inuits, that their whole culture is right there. Whereas Antarctica, nobody lives there except the scientists that come and set up stations and again, not a real long-term setup even.
Right. So. And we have a video. We actually have a couple of videos. Let's start with the first video that just kind of shows you Antarctica and the landmass and then the frozen ocean. And then we'll go into two videos on the conveyor belt, which is how the water kind of moves around and gets the stuff going. So if we can see that first video, this will show you on the bottom hemisphere here. So we're tipping the world upside down. That seasonal ice. So you'll see the ocean kind of freezing and retreating, freezing and retreating.
And again, there you're seeing sea ice. So we're seeing the ocean itself, these ice sheets.
But then here we're going to move on to land, so you can see the difference between the frozen ocean versus land. So this is the actual continent, Antarctica, surrounded by the Southern Ocean. So all just frozen, or frozen water, essentially, but on land. And this is fresh water, right? This isn't salt water.
Yeah, this is all fresh water. In fact, most of the fresh water, what is it, around 60%, I believe, of fresh water on our planet is actually contained on Antarctica. So even though a lot of the fresh water we get from lakes, and we have some that are in the glaciers up in the Arctic as well, most of it's actually on Antarctica.
So that's where it is. When we talk about our fresh water being locked up, it's locked up in Antarctica.
It is. A lot of it is.
We can't get it. I know I've had people say, why don't we bring like buckets down there and just melt it? I don't think it would work.
That would be a very expensive trip.
Yes,
if you have a
for
lot of
sure.
Buckets.
For sure. I was going to say something else about Antarctica, and I cannot remember what I was going to say. Oh, what about, same thing with seasons, right? As far as, except theirs is opposite of ours.
Yes, it is the opposite. So when it's nice and warm, when it's summer in the Arctic, it's winter in the Antarctic, which again, rough conditions all the time. But they have the biggest change, biggest physical change anywhere seen on the planet. The amount of change of the ice on the... Actually, now I sound like I'm contradicting myself from what I said earlier, the biggest change. But they see a bigger physical change on Antarctica with the seasons than they do any other place on Earth.
So just the idea of ice to water, well, it's around the ocean, too, though. It's not
Yeah, around just, the ocean, right.
Right. So it's going to be just physical change. So physical change of ice to water, water to ice to water, water to ice. So that sheer amount is more than any other physical change that happens in the world, right?
Yes.
So speaking of that, let's talk about, we kind of looked at that graphic with the Arctic and how that ice factory is there. Let's take a look at how the water is kind of affected and the currents that we see go around the ocean here. So there are conveyor belts that go around Antarctica, and this is what kind of moves it. This is where all the oceans in essentially kind of come together, right? Like in this conveyor belt. So if we can watch the first conveyor belt video, we'll be able to show you a little bit more about what I'm talking about. Try and take it out of words and into visualization. So we'll look at that first video.
And surrounding the whole continent, as they're bringing up the video, is this ACC, is what it's called, the Antarctic Circumpolar Current. So we'll also get to see that nice little circle around Antarctica.
Yeah, and this is driven off of density. We talked about density on Oceanography Day and about like how warm water and cold waters mix and how they drive each other and how these currents in return drive our climate. So this is how it works, where we've got typically warmer water up on top. It's less dense. As it cools, it'll like goes up towards the Arctic. It cools, sinks down as because cold water is more dense than warm water. It's driven down the other way. It'll go to areas where it warms and cools, and it just literally drives and moves the oceans, like you were saying, that current. So tipping down to the southern hemisphere here, what are we seeing,
Amanda? So again, we're seeing how the currents are moving through all of these different oceans and how, like you were saying earlier, the one world ocean, how they all kind of come together. But now we're starting to see that nice little circumpolar current, how you can see that water entering in there. And then making its way clockwise around Antarctica.
And this is where we see literally the Atlantic, Pacific, and Indian Oceans mixing, because we're having all water come down around that current around Antarctica. All of the ocean's water are coming in, going out, coming in, going out. So they're literally all mixing up. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of awesome. We have one more video just to kind of drive home here. These currents are extremely, extremely important. So if you were into studying this kind of stuff, or this gets you excited again, these currents play a very huge role in our climate. So when we talk about an upcoming classes, global climate change, we are referring oftentimes to changes in these currents, either slowing down or speeding up or getting more fresh water, more salt water. So it's really important. Let's go ahead and take a look at that second video. And this one's just kind of a fun one. It starts with little feet moving around, but eventually you'll see it'll turn into the world. So just hang tight here for a second.
I haven't seen this yet.
So it just starts spinning. It kind of represents the Earth here, but we'll start to see the actual world come into play. But this is if you were to flatten out all the currents of the world.
And one thing to note here is that ACC, the Antarctic Circumpolar Current, is the only one that goes completely around the globe. Like, it doesn't go off in some funny pattern. It's a complete circle. And it does flow and carry about 150 times more water than all the world's rivers combined. So just that one ACC, that one current, carries a lot of water.
So now we kind of get it into play here in context. Just tons of movement, though. I mean, if you didn't know that water moved or like was driving off of density currents, like, I don't know, it always baffles me that water is in motion all the time.
Yeah. And what's interesting, too, is that the water it can be flowing really, really fast in one area, and just on the other side of that, it's not nearly as fast.
Right.
And it's kind of one of those interesting things to see the anomalies that we have in our Science on a Sphere data sets at the aquarium.
All right, we can bring it back here now. Perfect. So with those currents, though, there have been some pretty rough seas.
Yes. In these areas where those currents are, they're often referred to as, well, there's a few different names. If you're looking at the latitudes, we've got the Roaring 40s, the Furious 50s, and the Screaming 60s. They sound like pleasant areas to visit, don't they?
Yes.
But that's just because these seas are so rough. In fact, they're also known, this area is known as the horse latitudes. If you look at it on some maps, they'll be labeled horse latitudes because as legend goes, I understand it, that people would actually see horses sometimes, and not just horses, but other objects from boats in the water in these areas, because fishermen, or not fishermen, explorers, people who are out on the boats, would encounter such rough conditions that they would be tossing things off their boat to help gain control of their ship and keep it from capsizing and going under. So they were known as the horse latitudes from seeing these things in those areas from...
That does not sound fun.
No.
I would not want to go do that.
No.
So, all right. So we've kind of talked a little bit about the Antarctic Ocean, or the Southern Ocean, how it all works. Let's talk about the animals that live there. This food web is a little bit different than what we saw with the Arctic, because the Antarctic food web is really driven off the krill, right?
It is. So while we still have the basis of, you know, the phytoplankton, those that are using the sunlight to actually create... food, produce their own food, that's pretty much all being eaten by the krill.
So these guys right here.
And then from there, everything else pretty much gets fed. So it's interesting to see in there how many lines are connected to that krill, whereas the other one was a little bit more of a web, like more things were connected and played out in different ways. But here we've got still the basis of that phytoplankton, and then you've got the krill eating the smaller phytoplankton, and then everything is pretty much centered around this little animal here.
And even with this krill, I think this is a perfect picture. This part up here, this is the sea ice. And one of the main things that juvenile krill feed on are the algae that live in the bottom of the sea ice. And especially in spring and summer, where that phytoplankton is booming, you're going to find krill just eating like crazy under the bottom of the sea ice. So they really heavily depend on that phytoplankton. And just like you said, Amanda, I think you wrapped it up perfectly when you were like, from there up, everything's the krill. Like, the krill is really the keystone species of Antarctica.
And it's amazing because they're so small. You think, well, how can something so small be so important in this area? And wow, so many animals feed off of it. Even the largest animals on our planet, the blue whale, is known for feeding on krill. And obviously the good thing is krill likes to hang out in big groups. It can be very dense. Certain areas where they can have, 30,000 krill in like a cubic, a cubic meter.
30,000 like krill per cubic meter. Mm-hmm.
And so fortunately they're very dense, so it is easier for a large animal to eat a lot of it and actually have a meal out of it. But
and then kind of like the doom and gloom, which is doom and gloomy. Yeah. But when they talk about that sea ice changing, well, there's both the ice on land in Antarctica that's at risk, and then there's also the sea ice that's at risk. So just like Arctic, the sea ice will recede and there's less of it, but less sea ice means less plankton for the juvenile krill to feed on. So that is, again, one of the big concerns with krill, just because they literally help to keep the balance of everything, which is why we call them the keystone species. They are the key to the balance of that ecosystem. And like you said, they're really small, about up to 2.5 inches long, and one of the most abundant multicellular animals. So they're thought to be one of the largest aggregations of marine life on the planet. Just like you said, coming together in those swarms.
And it's actually becoming more popular for even people to get in on this now. You can, I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing. People are, you know, sometimes...
Krill oil,
and something you can buy at, I'm sure, plenty of places, but yeah, I don't know, weighing the balance.
Yeah, they've talked about how that it's, from what I've heard, it's not good. So that they're over-harvesting the krill, that we're tapping into another resource that if we were to overfish this would be detrimental. Mm-hmm. So we really have to make wise choices, especially as the consumer right now, do our research. We should even do our research just to make sure that we're passing on the right information about what's sustainable and what is not.
Exactly. Not to say that it necessarily is wrong, but learning where the limits are for overfishing, just like we've had to do with some species. So hopefully we'll just be more aware of it before we get too carried away.
Yeah, and it's something that's brand new. It's really only been booming the last couple of years, but we know what happens when a new market forms and kind of takes off. So, but something kind of interesting, the lifespan of krill.
They don't live very long.
Well, longer than you would think. 5 to 7 years. The Antarctic, 5 to 7 years. Can you, like,
I guess if it was that cold, that would seem like a long time.
So, I mean, just longer than I would have imagined. So
longer than our squid.
That's true.
Yeah.
All right, so let's get in. We're now going to start moving up the food web again like we have with others. But we're going to talk about some animals that have some crazy adaptations for living in these freezing temperatures. So let's start with the Antarctic cod.
Well, before we talk about the Antarctic cod, I like to think back to my days at Michigan State and the winters in Michigan. I don't know if any of you watching have had to endure a cold winter, but if you've ever had to go out to a car and try to start it in the middle of the winter, it's not always a fun, pleasant experience. You need your car to warm up, and you have certain things you put in your car to make sure it doesn't freeze, like antifreeze. Well, this fish actually has antifreeze in its inside its body to prevent it from freezing. Not a brand name, but basically its body is producing basically an antifreeze. So it's not being frozen in this really frigid water that it's living in. So the Antarctic cod has, it's actually not a true cod, even though it's called a cod. They actually get that name because apparently they taste a lot like cod. Hmm. So they're not cod, they're their own group of animals. But yeah, the Antarctic cod has, isn't that a lovely fish? That creature has antifreeze in its blood. And I just am amazed by that. I think that's pretty crazy.
So the question is, did whoever discovered or produced antifreeze know about the Antarctic cod? I wonder how they discovered, oh, let's put this in our engines.
Like, what came up with the idea of I don't know if they had looked into things enough yet.
Probably not.
To discover that.
Probably not. But still, I mean, it'd be crazy. But, oh, yeah, I went on this fishing expedition in Antarctica. No, just, you know, obviously that wouldn't happen.
Right.
But, yeah, that'd be kind of interesting.
But there's some other interesting things about these animals, too, is they also have a cartilaginous skeleton. And I didn't even realize that before because we know that, you know, sharks have no bones, but these guys also have a cartilaginous skeleton. They also don't have a swim bladder, which is a lot like a shark. They have instead these fatty deposits to help them with their buoyancy. So kind of some funny little facts.
Different, yeah, guys. Totally different environment that we're used to compared to the fish off of our coast. So yeah. Just totally different.
And these can be a little bit bigger. They can get up to 300 pounds.
That's
so these are bigger fish than what we were talking about before.
Definitely. Another kind of cool one is the mackerel ice fish. They've got some weird stuff going on.
Yeah, well, they get their name from their pale color that they have. And one of the reasons for that is they don't have any red blood cells. They instead do rely on plasma to actually go through their body so that they don't have freezing blood cells. So the Antarctic cod was able to keep the blood, but with this antifreeze, these guys are like, we're not going to deal with it. We're just going to use plasma instead.
So the plasma will move the oxygen around the body to help them get proper oxygen to the muscles and all that stuff. Yeah, and they are eaten by seals, and they're also commercially harvested.
Yeah, they are commercially harvested. So
at least they wouldn't be bloody, right?
I didn't think about that, but yeah, I guess maybe you're right.
All right, let's talk about the Patagonian toothfish. This one's a little bit different as well. They are also commercially fished and one that we kind of need to keep an eye on, right?
Yeah, one of the reasons they are overly fished is because people discovered they tasted really good in restaurants when they were put on the menu as Chilean sea bass. This was a very, very popular fish. On menus for a long time until we got kind of aware of the fact that we were overfishing them and that we were going to lose these animals from the ocean if we didn't pull back a little bit. So these are a fish that I wouldn't encourage you to eat if you saw one somewhere on a menu. But hopefully, again, with, you know, checking ourselves before we do the overfishing and putting, you know, limits in place, we'll still have these and you'll still eventually be able to enjoy them again.
And with the Patagonian toothfish too, I was going to say something about them and I can't remember because I was just thinking about something we said.
All I know is that they are very commercially fished. Oh, they also... Oh,
I know what I was going to say. I was going to say, speaking of overfishing, that's what it was. We actually have a day partially dedicated to that with overfishing and populations and sustainability. So we actually have a lecture dedicated partially to that. So we'll get into why people overfish, how it happens, how we prevent it. Caleb, Kira, why are you, why, wait, what, What, you're talking about biomimicry. That's one of the coolest areas of biology. Super awesome. Biomimicry, yes, it totally is. So we should really get it. You know, we should maybe have a lecture just on biomimicry because we could get into some fun stuff with that. So yes, Caleb, I agree. Okay, so we're going to move on to talk about some of the mammals back up the food web, which even though it's up the food web or a little bit higher up, also will feed on krill. Right, so if we go talk about the crab eater seal, not a crab eater.
No, the crab eater seal is not a crab. It has a very funny, I don't know how it got its name, because it doesn't eat crabs at all. Instead, it does feed on krill. And so if you were to look inside the mouth of a seal, usually they have sort of normal looking, well, I say normal, I'm used to seeing sea lion and seal teeth, I guess. But they're just kind of pointed teeth, nothing special. You might think, okay, well, these are good for eating fish and
like,
grabbing things, maybe
like
swallowing a hole.
Canines like and molars and
like
stuff.
Like your dog teeth and things like that. Mm-hmm. So if you compare it to like a blue whale that also feeds on krill, instead he doesn't have any teeth at all. He's got all these baleen plates that help him filter it out of the water. Well, these guys kind of have a filter inside their mouth with their teeth as well. So their teeth actually have these little, they have parts of their teeth that kind of come up and make like little kind of holes and kind of like a filter and a strainer so that they can actually feed on this fish in the water too. Very bizarre looking
fish.
We
have a picture of their mouth. So if we can pull that up, we can see the teeth of the crab eater seal. And they, of course they're not eating the crabs, but they are eating krill, right? Lots and lots of krill. So there's also a lot of them.
Yes, there's actually 15 million crab eater seals believed to be their population around the world, of course in the Antarctic, which is more than just about any other, it is more than any other pinniped, seal or sea lion or walrus. But one of the top mammals really in the world. So there's a lot, 15 million, that's a lot. That's a lot of seals.
It's a lot of seals. I don't know if you saw on the teeth there. If we can go full screen one more time. So right here, we have the teeth. I don't know if you can see that. I'm not sure if you're seeing that there. But the teeth are like little catchers. They're like little strainers almost that'll help them eat all of that krill.
Yeah, because you'll notice with their mouth closed, you can see how there's not a whole lot of space for stuff to get through. So that is acting as the filter.
So it's like baleen, kind of, in the sense that it filters, but it's made out of teeth. And their main predators are leopard seals. Leopard seals are, I don't know, most people think of seals cute and cuddly. Oh, look, this guy eats krill, right? But the leopard seal, he's like a whole other ball game, right?
Yeah, he's not one of those cute and cuddly ones. Mm. I have to even say that. Yeah, he doesn't look very cute. He looks kind of scary. Some of the videos you can see of them online are pretty intimidating. I don't think I'd want to be in the water around a leopard seal. But yes, they have teeth that are designed for capturing things like penguins and other fish, other seals. They are definitely carnivores, and they'll prey on the bigger animals, not just tiny fish.
They tend to hang out by themselves a little bit too. So oftentimes if you can see animals kind of cluster, even seals like harbor seals that we have locally, they don't like lay up on top of each other like sea lions do, which we'll talk about that. But these guys like are pretty much always by themselves. You won't really see them with other leopard seals, which is kind of unique for seals because usually you'll have at least some others around, but in this case not with him.
Now what's interesting about them is that they don't seem to get along too well on land, and that's true of most seals, but it's interesting, you can see footage of penguins that are kind of walking by these leopard seals and don't seem to be very concerned about their presence there on the ice, but a totally different story if they're in the water.
Absolutely. And their only main predators are the orcas, and they travel the greatest distance of all the Antarctic seals. So quite a bit going on there. All right, so let's move on. Let's talk about, speaking of eating penguins, let's talk about some penguins.
Okay.
Right? People typically think of penguins in Antarctica. One of the things I always like to point out, we talked about how the polar bears were in the Arctic, and penguins are in the Antarctic or Southern Hemisphere. I can't say Antarctic specifically. But that Coke commercial, right, where you have the polar bear and the penguin at Christmas time playing together and best friends, Never going to happen.
Not going to happen.
Never going to happen. So they are polar opposites.
Yes, they are.
I know. I'm just cracking myself up. Anyway, so yeah, they have polar opposites, basically, where you will only find penguins in the southern hemisphere. And there's only a few that are specifically Antarctic.
Yeah, there's actually only four species that spend their time on Antarctic or on Antarctica, especially one time that everyone gets out of the area is during the winter time there. The emperor penguins are the only ones that stay there during breeding season, is during the darkest, coldest, harshest parts of the year. But the Adélie penguin, the Chinstrap, the Gentoo, and the emperor are the four that you'll actually see on Antarctica. A lot of the other penguins that are associated with the southern hemisphere are not necessarily in the cold, icy areas. Mm-hmm. Even at the aquarium, we have some Magellanic penguins that are found off the coast of South America, but they're animals that live on the beach. They don't need to have the snow and ice. We don't have a cold exhibit space for them.
No.
Because they're used to Southern California beach living, or maybe not in Southern California. But anyway,
temperate water. So they do pretty well with our surrounding temperature, our surrounding water. In our exhibit, it's about 60 degrees. They keep the water a little cooler, but it's just ambient air temperature. So whatever air temperature we have here is pretty similar to what they would have. So the whole idea that the penguins need cold is not entirely true. Wes, there's a leopard seal and happy feet. You know what? This is actually kind of embarrassing because I have never seen Happy Feet.
You haven't seen
Happy Feet? No, I have not seen Happy Feet. And Happy Feet 2, if you actually have the DVD, I can't believe I'm telling everyone this, you can go to the special features, and I'm doing a special on the DVD talking about blue whales.
She's famous.
I know. I'm on Happy Feet 2. So anyway, if you're interested, you can find me there talking about blue whales. So, but yeah, I've never seen Happy Feet. And I actually have a Happy Feet little stuffed animal. I don't know, super cute. Never seen it. So anyway, talking about penguins. Yeah, so we're just going to talk about one type of penguin. We'll talk about the emperor penguin because they're the biggest, right? I'm going to talk about the biggest and the best. But let's tell me a little bit about the emperor penguin.
Okay, well, they're the largest of all the penguin species. And they, like I said, they actually spend time on the continent when it's really, really cold and dark and miserable. And this is actually the time that the poor dads have to take care of their, basically raising their family. And when they court, and it takes about 2 months for courtship, and then about 2 months of staying with those eggs, while the mother actually will leave and go hunting and fishing. And the dad is the one primarily, or the only one, responsible for taking care of the eggs. And of course, being really, really cold, these animals don't lay nests. They actually use the heat of their body to incubate their eggs, and they have to keep those eggs on their feet. And if they were to somehow walk and move and have those eggs roll off, it could be just a matter of seconds and that chick would die. That it wouldn't survive being in that egg on the ice because the conditions are so harsh there. But the mother will go away for about 65 days or so in that range. They'll go out and get all the food that they need and then come back and share it with the family.
And then they switch, right?
And so, then they switch roles.
So the little chick will then have to be transferred to the mom, and kind of her little belly hangs over the baby and keeps the baby warm. And that too. So you said that doesn't the egg like almost instantaneously crack? Like it's done.
It could be, they lose the egg,
it's gone. And then the chick too, if the chick hits that ice for more than a couple seconds, it's going to freeze to death. So it's a little dance, literally, where they have to kind of get this all down. And like you said, just kind of reiterating, there's no nest. They're doing it all themselves, which is pretty labor intensive, right?
Yeah.
Especially for a bird, right? I mean, we think about like humans who have a 9-month gestation and carry the baby around. Sure, that works for us. But they're a bird. They're supposed to have it easy where they lay
an
egg.
And still, I have to give credit for these dad penguins because they're doing this without eating themselves. Mm-hmm. So he's not eating while the mother is out getting the food. And he's taking care of this baby and keeping it warm. And
going from there.
Good dad.
So let's. We have a video of Emperor Penguin. So we'll just watch a short little snippet of this, and then we are going to. We're just almost out of time. Talk about some conservation issues and see where we're at then. And but wanted to show you a little bit of video about these emperor penguins and how they literally will all come together for these mating sessions and then incubating sessions and all that stuff. So if we can watch this video real quick, we'll show you what it's like.
When the temperature is as cold as minus 50 degrees Fahrenheit, it helps if there's a warm body nearby. Emperor penguins in the Antarctic are known to huddle together for warmth. But what we didn't realize was that they were creating a wave when new penguins joined the huddle. And that wave helped move the huddle en masse. Physicist Daniel Zitterbart from the University of Erlangen-Nuremberg in Germany recorded high-resolution time-lapse images of the huddle near the Neumayer Antarctic Research Station. They were then speeded up to see what was happening. As penguins move in, generally from the rear, penguins in the huddle make small steps in a formation to help the tightly formed mass remain intact. Zitterbart and his colleagues point out that it is crucial that the huddle is continually reorganized to give each penguin a chance to spend sufficient time inside the huddle compared to time on the periphery. The wave is created by the small steps, estimated at just 2 to 4 inches. The researchers suggest those steps serve 3 purposes. First, to keep the pack as dense as possible. Second, it leads to forward motion of the entire huddle. And thirdly, over time, leads to its reorganization. Separate smaller huddles can also merge into larger clusters. The emperor penguins in these videos are all male, and most carried an egg on his feet. The females had not yet returned to the colony. The study was published in the online scientific journal PLOS One.
So I thought that was kind of cool. I don't know, I saw that video, I'm like, that's pretty smart. That's pretty amazing for them to, and they're all carrying the egg, you know, yeah, but that wave, I don't know, I thought that was kind of cool, so I wanted to share that. So, all right, so we will jump down and just really quickly talk about some of the conservation issues going on with Antarctica. They're having the same kind of issues that the Arctic is having, right?
They are having issues with receding ice and also these glaciers, and that's going to have an impact on things as glaciers are moving off, you know, again, we were talking about how tall and how big these are, and then they're making their way off the continent and down into the water as well.
If we can pull this full screen real quick, this will kind of show the warming areas for the environment here, but you can just see, like, when they're talking about, we have the temperature trends on the bottom here. We're starting to get some warmer stuff going on the outside here, and that's creating a little bit of a problem. We're also talking about, if we're referring to the ice on land, that if that water melts, or if that ice melts, we are now adding fresh water to a saltwater ocean. And we're talking about significant amounts of fresh water that are being added to a saltwater system. And remember, we've got that current going around and around and around right there. So it's driven by density, salt water, fresh water, cold water, warm water. These are all playing a role in the density. So a great documentary about penguins is called March of the Penguins. It's so good. Another one I've not seen.
You haven't seen that either?
No!
You all should see that. Yes. It'll tell you a lot more about the penguins.
All right. So we are just about wrapping up with class. So thank you all for joining us. Great participation today. If you have any questions, please make sure and email me. We had one video of krill that we didn't get to, so I am going to post that. You'll notice under course assignments, I'm starting to post the links for all the videos from the classes if you want to go back and watch the full videos yourself, or just watch them again, or extended versions. You can kind of see what I was doing with the videos there. So those are up. Again, don't forget quiz and discussion board. Check the board for the extra credit. And midterm coming up in 2 weeks. So if you have any questions, get in touch. Amanda, thank you for being here.
You're very welcome. Thanks for having me.
And we will see you next week. Have a good week.